7 years old. Third row pew, John 3:16. Something changed in me. Red letters coming off the page, flooding my heart with amazing grace. I knew then I believed, and those roots run deep. Oh, I've been through some faith-shaking hard times, but nothing's gonna make me forget. Every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I could hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loved me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know His word is true. It all started with a heart-stirring, spirit-moving Sunday sermon. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Gonna have my worries, well that's part of life. But I think of those stories about what my God can do. He's still moving like He did back then. Born again people, can I get an amen? We've all seen the proof. He makes all things new. Even all those faith-shaking hard times, I never wanna stop remembering. Every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I could hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loves me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know His word is true. It all started with a heart-stirring, spirit-moving Sunday sermon. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Sunday sermon. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, ain't no doubt, so I'm gonna keep on talking about. Every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I could hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loves me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know I'll make it through. All because of those heart-stirring, spirit-moving Sunday sermons. Devil gonna try and take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me.
Amen. 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 Hallelujah. All right, let's stand up. Amen. It's Sunday morning. Hallelujah. Woo! We gonna have church in here today. I'm looking for my friends, and I know who they are. They not here. All right, but that's okay. We gonna have church. Hallelujah. Yeah. Woo! All right, we're gonna start with birthdays and anniversaries. Is anybody in here had a birthday or an anniversary? Anybody in here had a birthday or an anniversary? Okay. You guys can sing happy birthday to me then. How about that? All right.
Ready? Ready?
Go ahead. Y'all sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right, amen. Wow. 65, how does it feel, guys, how does it feel? Is it okay? Oh, come on now. You've already been there. You can tell me. 65 is not so bad. Hallelujah. It was a good year. Go ahead. We're going to get started and sing some praise and worship. How about that?
That you were drawing a line in the sand.
And I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come. Let it live in me. This is my prayer. This is my plea. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand, and I want to be standing on your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come, let it live in me. This is my prayer, this is my plea. Let the worshipers arise. Let the son and the daughter sing. I surrender in my all. I surrender to the King. Let the worshipers arise. Let the son and the daughter sing. Surrender in my all. I surrender to the King. Father, I hear it growing louder, the song of your redeem, as the saints of every nation are awakening to sing. From our hearts there comes an anthem. Oh, hear the heavens ring. This is our song, a song to our King. And let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing.
Oh, let them sing. Come on, hallelujah.
I surrender in worshippers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing.
Oh, we're going to sing to you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
I surrender in my all.
Oh, I surrender.
I surrender to the King. Let the worshippers arise. And the daughters sing.
Oh, let us sing from our hearts to you, Jesus. Give him worship.
I surrender in my all.
We're going to give it all to you, Jesus, today.
I surrender to the King.
I surrender, Lord. Let the worshipers rise. Come on now.
Let the sons and the daughters sing. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King.
King Jesus, hallelujah.
Amen.
King Jesus in the house, hallelujah. Amen. When he's here, we got to praise him. Hallelujah. When he's here, we got to praise him. Woo, hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Beat now. Go ahead.
Amen.
Wrong lyrics, babe. Video down.
baby. I know my God's gonna fight for me. So when the devil starts trying to get
you got me? It's praise the Lord. That's what it's called. Praise the Lord. You got me? I got a new guy up here in the booth. I guess you guys noticed that. But he's doing good. Don't say nothing to him. He's got a gun. We don't want him to go off in the church here. Don't say too much to him. Woo! But, woo-wee! All right, Dale, you ready? If you see us out on the streets, we still love you, man. We do. We love you. Don't worry about it.
I remember when a long-lost sinner, he met a good, good God. I remember when my heart was broken, but now it's not. I've tasted and I've seen, you've been so good to me. From the moment that you changed my life, Lord, you never stop. I'm gonna sing it, I'm gonna shout it, I'm gonna lift my hands and praise. No matter what is gonna come my way, all you've done for me, I give you the glory. From the valley to the victory, I know my God is gonna fight for me. So when the devil comes trying to get you, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil comes trying to get you, gonna praise the Lord. From the moment when the sun starts rising till the sun goes down, I'm surrounded by a million miracles. I can feel them now. I've tasted and I've seen, you've been so good to me. Got a melody inside my heart, oh, what a sweet, sweet sound. I'm gonna sing it, I'm gonna shout it, I'm gonna lift my hands and praise. No matter what is gonna come my way, all you've done for me, I give you the glory. From the valley to the victory, I know my God is gonna fight for me. So when the devil comes trying to get me, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil comes trying to get me, gonna praise the Lord.
In every high or every low, hallelujah, in Christ alone. And here on earth, when I get home, my hope is found in Christ alone. I'm gonna sing it,
come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna shout it,
come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna lift my hands in
come
praise.
Come praise the Lord.
Come on now. Woo!
Come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna sing it,
come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna shout it,
come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna lift my hands in
come
praise.
Praise the Lord.
No matter what is gonna come my
come
way,
praise the Lord.
All you've done for me,
come praise the Lord.
I give you the glory.
Come praise the Lord.
From the valley to the victory, I know my God is gonna fight for me. So when the devil comes try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil comes try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. So when the devil comes try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil comes try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. You know, hold up just a minute, Dale. You know, I came up here last Sunday and I told you to pray for me. I told you we were having a lot of difficulties. I know that most of you know the situation with my wife. But I'm going to tell you, we got up here and we prayed. And let me tell you, when you do pray, don't think the devil's going to leave you alone.
Amen.
He's going to try to jump on you because he wants you to show him that he's not right, that my God is still in charge.
Amen.
No matter what. And he wants, my God wants me to stand up against that devil. So the couple days were bad. After we prayed, they were bad. They were bad. But now, I'm going to tell you, the last few days, the Lord has just shown me that He's God. He's God. I'm not. This is not my battle anymore.
Amen.
It's His battle. It always has been His battle. It's His child. It's not mine. I can't fix everything as a man. I want to, but I can't do it.
Amen.
So I'm going to trust that the Lord's going to do it.
Amen.
Amen.
If you've never been here, this is what we believe here.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. Broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see that there is only one salvation. We believe, we believe. God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, we believe that He conquered death, we believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptation, we believe, we believe. God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, we believe that He conquered death, we believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. The lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. Let love invade, let the church live loud. Our God will say, we believe, and the gates of hell will not prevail. For the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know Your love will never fail. We believe, we believe. God the Father, we believe in Jesus Christ, we believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion, we believe that He conquered death, we believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back, He's coming back again.
I think I know without a shadow of a doubt. I think I know without a shadow of doubt that those eastern skies could open up.
Amen.
And my God could say, today is the day. Bring my children home. They've had enough. It's time for glory. Hallelujah. Whew. Wow. You know, that's just, it's just the goodness of my God.
Amen.
And they, that's what you need. It's just the goodness of my God.
Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful.
Thank you, Lord.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Close like no other. I know you as a father, oh, I know you as a friend, and I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. My life lay down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful.
Even when I didn't know you were.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Goodness of God, oh, I will sing.
my God is good. Hallelujah.
Let's give God a good hand clap, will you? The Lord's been good to you. Give him a good hand clap this morning. Amen. Amen. I'm so glad today that even when we are not faithful, God remains faithful. He's not going to be faithful. He's always been faithful. He was faithful, and he is faithful, and always will be. And we're so thankful. We have a lot to be thankful for today. If you're glad to be here, say amen. I tell you, God is working in a mighty way. We're so thankful today. We're going to pray together. I want you to stand with me if you can as we agree together this morning. We're going to pray for Miss Maria Huggins. Her husband has passed away, and tomorrow will be a service at Second Baptist Church here in Dillon at 10 o'clock. And if you want to bring some food out to the church about 2:30 today, I'll get it over to her house. We've been praying for Miss Pat. Her brother's gone on to glory, and we were able to encourage her. We're going to keep encouraging you, Miss Pat. We thank God. Amen. Miss Judy Foley is still taking medication. She's fighting a good fight, and we're going to continue to lift her up. Brother Irvin, you know, he has dialysis, and he's in and out the hospital. We're going to continue to pray for him. When he's not in the hospital, he's at church, and we thank God for him today. If you have a need this morning, I want to tell you something. My God is able. He's able to take care of whatever need you have today. God can take care of your need. He's our God in our worst day. I'm so glad today the Bible tells us that God's grace is greater than all of our sin. God is greater. Will you say amen? I thank the Lord today for this ministry. I thank God for what he's doing. I tell you what we have to always do. Always look up. Always look up and know God is always up to something. And I pray today, if you don't know the Lord, when you leave here today, you would know him as Lord and Savior. And we give God all this service today. Will you say amen? Let's pray together. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We thank you, dear Lord God, that you have built a bridge. You, the Pontifex, you have made a way that we could come to your throne where we could find grace and mercy in our time of need. God, today we need you, Lord. We're not depending on ourselves. We're not depending on the government. We depend on you, God. And we look to you, Lord. We honor you, God. We put you first in our life. And we thank you, dear Lord God, that you are the God of grace and mercy. And we thank you for your long suffering. And God, as we thank you for the song that we just sang, that God, you have always been chasing after us. And we bless you, dear Lord God. We thank you you didn't give up. And we thank you, dear Lord God, where we didn't give in, you didn't give up. And we love you, Lord God, today. We thank you that we could come to the house of the living God and praise you. And we thank you, Lord Jesus. We pray for all these needs. We pray for those who lost loved ones. God, be with them. You are the one who gives us the comforter, the Holy Spirit, God, to comfort us in our time of need. We thank you, dear God, that you never leave us alone. And whatever we have need of, God, you provide it. Thank you for Jesus, dear Lord God. Without Jesus, we could not do anything. But we thank you, dear Lord God, that we are overcomers. God, we are more than conquerors. We stand today as believers in victory. And our victory is in Jesus, and we praise you. God, we pray you'll be glorified today in our efforts to come and worship you and praise you. And God, we want to thank you right now for answering prayer. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. And the church said amen and amen. You may be seated. Give God a good hand clap of praise, will you? Amen. You can either be a chosen frozen or a happy clapper. God is so good.
Good morning. Miss Netta, do you mind pulling, or Mr. Dell, the experience in God? We, ladies, time for our fall Bible study, so excited about that. James 5, 13 through 16. James 5, 13 through 16 is the prayer of faith. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. So as the ladies come together, and we have chosen this time to do the Experiencing God, it is a 12-week Bible study. So you won't need to buy but one workbook, because we're going to break it into 6 weeks in the fall and 6 weeks in the spring. And because it is 12 weeks, it's a little more. As you can see, it's $22. If you have trouble with that, no problem. Just see me, and we'll make sure you get a workbook. So we're planning on starting October 7th, and we'll go to come to the church at 11 o'clock on Saturdays. And we'll go through our lesson for the week and watch video. And there's coffee, and people bring donuts and food. So there's always, it's a good time. And we use that time to confess our faults to one another and pray for one another. The key here is accountability, and it helps us to hold each other accountable. And that's what we need in our Christian faith, somebody to hold us up, lift us up, and hold us accountable. So we're looking forward to that. Y'all don't need to pray about that. You just need to come on, okay? And if you haven't been coming, you need to come on. It's a lot of fun, and we look forward to having you.
Amen. Amen. Let's stand together, will you please? Give the Lord a good hand clap. We're going to worship the Lord in giving today. Amen. Praise the Lord. God is so good. We thank the Lord for the opportunity. Listen, come ladies and join the ladies, and everybody's invited to come during that time. It's a wonderful time. The Bible says iron sharpens iron. I want to say that aprons sharpen aprons, ladies. Amen. Y'all come together. It's a wonderful time that you strengthen each other in the Lord. We're going to worship the Lord in giving. Thank you so much for your faithfulness in giving. Never think that what you give is not enough. Everybody giving, it takes everybody to participate and give as we give to this ministry. And we thank God for what he's doing. He's working in a mighty way, and we praise him. We're never more like our God, the Lord Jesus, than when we're giving. So we're going to ask God to bless our time of giving today. Let's pray together. Father, we give you honor and glory and praise you because you are God. And we thank you, Lord God, for providing as we sing the song, Lord, you've always faithful. And we pray, Lord God, and we thank you for this ministry. And God, you said you're going to do it with us who has no strength. God, we look to you, Lord. You are our strength. You are our provider. And God, you provide for this ministry through your people. Lord, we don't look to outside people, people somewhere else or things. We look to you, Lord. And we thank you, Lord God. We praise you. Bless our time of giving. Multiply it, Lord, for the purpose of souls coming to thy kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All the children and ladies and gentlemen, come quickly as we worship the Lord in giving. Our children to go next door for our children's ministry.
Don't let go of tomorrow, 'cause it ain't even faith till your plan falls apart, but you still choose to follow. If it doesn't make sense right now, it will when it's over. There will be joy in the morning. There will be joy in the morning. Giving in to your feelings is like drowning in the shallows. Oh, you gotta keep believing, even in the middle of the unknown.
All right.
'Cause grace will be there when you come to the end of your road.
Willie. Best Friends Day, and I got an opportunity to talk to a bunch of my friends, and you know, I didn't get anybody that said they would come to church with me today, though. But I did get to go by and see a lot of my friends, and you know, they look at me a little different anymore. I'm not the same person I used to be. I'm thankful for that. Go ahead, Dal.
See a brand new man. the old man is dead. See, you're looking on the outside. If you could see inside instead, oh, you would see a brand new man. Cause the old dead. Oh, he's dead.
Amen. Let's all stand together, will you? How many know it's a great price to pay, to obey the Lord, and to be faithful to the Lord. In this life, the Bible teaches us there will be great opposition. I want you to think about for just a moment. As pastor of this church over the years, going on 21, I grew up in this town, know people in this town, and invite people to church. Try to help them and witness to them, and no response, no response whatsoever. So you have to, it don't feel good. Nobody likes to be rejected, say amen. And people just don't sometimes do what you wish they would do. So we have to do what the Lord says, say amen. And I want to thank God today for what he's doing. Thank God for this church. This ministry, we're not perfect, but we serve the perfect one. And I thank God today that we're doing the best we can to obey God. When he said, I'm going to open a door, no man's going to shut it, and I'm going to do it with you who has no strength. You know, it's all the Lord. It's all God, what God is doing here. Thank you so much for being here today. We're going to look together today in the scriptures, and we're going to look quite a bit, and today we don't have point one, two, and three. This is what we call an open letter sermon. Just open up and let her go. Amen. We're just going to see what the Lord has in store for us today. But we're going to talk about the Bible and the work of the Word and the work of the Holy Spirit. And what we need today is more God's Word. And we need to be filled with the Spirit of God. And the Scripture of God, through Paul writing to Timothy, and a lot of opposition. He was a young minister, and a lot of opposition when you're young in the ministry. Sometimes we need someone to come along beside us and encourage us and to help us today. And so we see that Paul's writing to young Timothy, and he's reminding him about the Word of God. He tells him that we know, you know, Timothy, you learned from a child, from your aunt and your mother, you heard the scriptures. And he says in 2 Timothy in chapter 3, verse 16, he says, all scripture, and that word scripture is every holy scripture, is given by inspiration of God. Now, I want to pause here for just a moment. I'm going to let you sit down. And I want you to think for just a moment. Right here we see the Word of God and the Spirit of God manifested. The scripture and the inspiration of God. The inspiration of God is the breath of God, which is the Holy Spirit. So we see here that all the Holy Word of God is given by the breath of God, the Holy Spirit, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction and instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, complete, and thoroughly, completely furnished unto all good works. You may be seated. May God bless his holy word. Father, we bless you today. And we ask, dear Lord God, today that we would very clearly hear, God, from you. Lord, we don't need to hear from a man. We need to hear from the preacher, the Holy Spirit. And we pray, dear Lord God, today, if there's anyone here today not saved, born again by the word and the Spirit, that God, today they will be saved. Now, Lord, we're not talking about somebody who just knows about the Word and knows about you, Lord, but someone who's been changed. And we thank you, dear Lord God, today it's you who does the saving. And God, we lift you up high that you can draw all people unto yourself. God, I pray, Lord Jesus, you would just breathe on this place today, dear God, that we would know we in your presence. Lord, we love you and praise you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the gift of the Holy Ghost from God. Lord, we just want to thank you for what you're going to do in the church today. Amen. So today we're looking together here and we're talking about the Word of God and the Spirit of God. The Bible says in 1 Peter 2 and 24, it talks about the work of the Holy Spirit in the early church. It's something that we need to know now that they knew then. The Bible said in 1 Peter in chapter 1 in verse 24, for all flesh is of grass, and all the glory is of the flower of grass, and the grass withers, and the flower thereof falls away. But the word of the Lord endures forever. And this is the word by which the gospel is preached unto you. We are preaching today the eternal word of God. This is not something that's going to fade away because of change of the weather, because of man's ideas, but this is the eternal word of God. And the point is, no matter how cleverly we may work out our theories about God's Word and the Holy Spirit of God, if our theories don't agree and line up with the Holy Scripture, they are unacceptable. We only believe what the Word of God has to say. I want to say it's a sad situation today that people are gathering all over the land and filling up buildings of churches and they don't even know what they believe. They don't even know what the church is teaching. They go because the crowd's there. They can hide in the crowd. But the believer today has a desire to know what the Bible has to say. And Paul said, Timothy, preach the word of God. It's good for doctrine. The doctrine is what you know about God. It's what you know about the word of God. You know you're saved because the Bible said you're saved, because you believed on the Lord Jesus and you received the Lord Jesus. God has given us the power of the Holy Spirit. So let's talk about Jesus first of all here. If anyone was indwelt by the Holy Spirit, it was the Lord Jesus. Amen. He is the living Word. And as I preach this message today, keep this in mind, that Jesus Christ is God. In Him dwelt the fullness of the Godhead bodily. He's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But we're going to see here how God worked His master plan that me and you, people like us, could be saved and accept eternal life. Jesus was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus was the incarnation of the Word of God. The Bible said, and the Word of God became flesh, and He dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as the only begotten of the Father. Jesus Christ is the living Word. Jesus is the incarnation. Jesus was God's only begotten Son. Jesus was from the beginning by whom the world were created. The Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and God spoke in the beginning. And Jesus Christ didn't become God one day. He's always been God, the Holy Trinity. And the Bible says in John 1:1, the Word was with God in the beginning, the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. He became with us. And notice here, Jesus took upon Him a human soul and body. Listen, friend, and it was made just like you and just like me. He became a man, Emmanuel, God with us. And Jesus, when He had set down aside His power to decide that is temporary, accepting the limitations of a natural human man, He came just like you and me. He had to put everything to aside so He could identify with you and identify with me. The Bible says in the book of Philippians in chapter 2, very clearly here in the scripture about the Lord Jesus. It says in 2 verse 6 about Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but He made Himself of no reputation and took upon Him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in the fashion as man, He humbled Himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Jesus, the Son of God, God Himself, became mankind. He humbled Himself. He left glory. He came down in the power of God the Holy Spirit, born in a virgin. So Jesus in his humanity, also his humility, although perfect, was really and truly human, yet he still was the Son of God in his humanity. And Jesus, he lowered himself for you and for me. He took on a natural body. So we see he, listen, even though he was like you and like me, the Bible says that yet he never sinned, he knew no sin, because he's God. Who in the world could live in a sinful world and never sin? Who in the world could live in a sinful world by all his temptations, everything the devil offered him, and refused it? Only God could do that. And the Bible says Jesus, he increased in wisdom, in his soul, in his stature, in his body, in favor with God, in favor with man. I tell you, if you ever have an opportunity to share your faith, it's because God, by the Holy Spirit inside of you as a born-again believer, he gives you favor with that person, that you can share the Lord Jesus with them. So think about this truth. God became a man in Christ Jesus, become 100% man, yet 100% God, so that he could identify with and conquer the soul and the body of man, winning our victory over death, hell, and sin in the grave, and this world, and that devil and Satan. He overcome everything that come against him. The Bible said Satan, he come to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus said, I come that you may have life and life more abundant. Give God a great big hand clap of praise. Jesus subjected himself to growth and development as a human child. The Bible said right there in the book of Philippians we just read that he humbled himself and he took on the form of a servant. He didn't think it was robbery to be equal with God because he himself is God. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews in chapter 2 in verse 16, the Bible says very clearly here in the scripture, it says, for verily he took not on himself the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Now Jesus didn't become an angel. He became a man just like you and just like me. Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to succor them that are also tempted. How in the world? Why in the world? Why does God say that we are to be holy? Because he's holy. Because God, by the power of the Word of God in your life, the strengthening of the Word of God, the whole armor of God, and the power of the Spirit of God in you, you have the God-given ability to overcome temptation and sin and the things of the devil. Somebody ought to shout and say amen. So we see here, the Bible makes it clear that Jesus is our security. We're going to heaven not because of anything that we could do. You cannot purchase your salvation with all the money in the world, the richest man in the world, without Jesus is dying and going to hell. He's on a hot trail today. If he thinks what he's got in his hand can get him eternal life. Jesus Christ is our security. In Hebrews 4, in verse 15, the Bible said, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was at all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. He did not sin. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. Aren't you glad today? Aren't you glad today that when you are hurting? Aren't you glad today when all hell has come down against you? Aren't you glad today when you stand beside a graveside and there's a loved one? Aren't you glad today when you're in the hospital? You may be by yourself. You think you by yourself, but aren't you glad today that you have one who's able to feel the way you feel? He identifies with us. And let me tell you something. He knows you better than you know yourself. He knows what you need. You need comfort.
And there's no comforter apart from the Prince of Peace, the Lord Jesus. He's the one who gives us the power of the Holy Spirit to comfort us in our time of need. When everything seems like it's all gone bad, you find yourself being all by yourself. You think nobody loves you. You look around, and there goes Jesus. And there goes God, the Holy Spirit. Somebody ought to say amen. The Bible tells us, let me tell you something. I hope and pray that everyone in here, none of you ever get sick. But let me tell you something. Before you go to the human doctor and the human medical center and the human hospital, the Bible says that we could come to the throne of grace and mercy, that we could come to the altar. We can bring our petition before Almighty God. We have direct access to the Lord God Himself. You can bring yourself before God and ask the great physician to heal your body. God is a healer. Somebody ought to say amen. He's our security and He's our sustainer. The scripture reveals Jesus lived in Nazareth until He was 30 years old, and no one had any idea that He was God in the flesh, Emmanuel. Mary's mother had some kind of inkling because of what the angels told her. The brothers and sisters didn't believe in Him. People in Nazareth said, who is this person? Who does he think he is? He's just a carpenter's son. He's Joseph's boy. They were so indignant, they actually tried to kill Jesus. The Bible says in the Gospel of Matthew, very clearly, in chapter 13, in verse 54, look what it says. And when he was coming to his own country, you know why he went to his own country? You know why God has saved you? So you can get your family saved. So you can go to your own country. That your wife and your husband and your children, your aunts and uncles, your grandmas and all these people, you know, that they get saved. That they get saved. I want to go ahead and say this. Wouldn't it be absolutely terrible that one of us here today in the sanctuary had the cure, knew the cure for cancer, but would not tell anybody about it? We got the cure for hell. We got the cure for eternal life. And we walk around and live like we got lockjaw. We don't tell everybody that Jesus saves. That Jesus will save you. I was sitting here thinking about the goodness of God in that little white chapel down that prison ground there in Columbia, South Carolina, where my mom and daddy couldn't get to me. My wife couldn't get to me. God got to me. God met me there in the penitentiary, and God changed my life. God touched me and changed me. I heard from God in that little chapel there with the rest of the prisoners. I tell you one thing, God touched me and I touched God. What we need today, church, is a real experience with God. I tell you, these people get me, say they love the Lord. They say they love Jesus. And you can't even pay them to come to the house of God. I tell you, we see here very quickly what the Bible teaches us about the Lord Jesus. Mary's mother, she didn't know what was going on. Think about it, church. They were so indignant. They tried to kill Jesus. The Bible says there that, you know, he went to his own country, taught them in the synagogue, and so much that they were astonished and said, whence has this man this wisdom and these mighty works? It's not just a carpenter's son. It's not just Mary called mother, his brother and James and Jose and Simon and Judas and his sisters. Are they not with us all? When sin has this man all these things? And they were offended in him. And Jesus said to them, the prophet is not without honor save in his own country and in his own house. And he did not many mighty works there because of their unbelief. Because of their unbelief. I tell you, God cannot work because of a person who will not believe. The question to ask is, what happened to Jesus between when he was living in Nazareth and the time he went out and began to proclaim the kingdom of the heaven is at hand? Think about it, church. And when he went about healing the sick and casting out devils and raising the dead, The answer is plain to see here. Jesus actually revealed the power that was in him, the power of the Holy Spirit. He actually revealed to them who he was. He's God in the flesh. He's God who gives the power to overcome. Jesus was born of the Holy Spirit. And when he began his ministry at 30, the Holy Spirit came upon him. Listen, I'm not going to say something like a new way, but a revealed way. It revealed to the people that he was God. And John the Baptist saw the Holy Spirit descend and remain on Jesus. Let me tell you something. If you're saved, the Holy Spirit will not abandon you. He will not abandon you. You're sealed with the Holy Ghost until the day of redemption. The Bible tells us it's revealed here and recorded in the scripture in all four of the Gospels in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Always know Jesus was and is the Father's Son from all eternity, long before the crowd at the Jordan heard the voice of God say, "This is my beloved Son." He's always been God and he always will be the Son of God. The Bible says in the scripture in John 1 and verse 29, the Bible says, "And the next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him, said, Behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. This he said, After me cometh a man which I prefer before me, for he was before me. And I knew him not, but he that should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water." Listen very carefully. "And John gave witness or bear record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, Upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which will baptize you with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God." We can never ever enjoy the power of God apart from knowing the Lord Jesus is our personal Savior. To be a Christian is to be Christ-like, is to be able to imitate Christ. Jesus was born of the Holy Ghost. Have you been born again? You're born twice, you die once. Amen? Come on. I tell you, if you're born twice, you're going to live forever. You're born again. Jesus was baptized by the Holy Ghost that he was on him and in him. Not that he needed the Holy Spirit because he was God. It was just to manifest to the people that he was God. And Jesus was led by the Spirit, the Holy Ghost, Matthew 4:1. Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness and to be tempted of the devil. Notice, the Spirit of God led him up to be tempted, tried, and tested. Now, you don't think that we're going to be tempted, tried, and tested in this life? You think and look around sometime and wonder why things are so hard and things are so difficult and things are so rough? Sometime God just wants to test you. God just wants to test you. I like what the prophet Ezekiel had to say in Ezekiel chapter 3 and verse 12. Listen to what he said. "Then the Spirit took me up, and I heard behind me a voice of a great rushing, saying, Blessed be the glory of the Lord from his place. And I heard also the noise of the wings of the living creatures that touched one another, and the noise of the wheels over against them, and a noise of a great rushing, so that the Spirit lifted me up and took me away, and I went in bitterness and the heart of my spirit, but the hand of the Lord was strong upon me." You think about it, church. If we don't have these tough times, if we don't experience the work of God in our life, we'll be so weak and so wimpy. When the devil comes, we won't be able to stand. I like what the Bible said about Ezekiel. He heard. I tell you something, friend, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We need to hear God more. You're not going to hear God down the street and everywhere else. You hear God from the Word of God. And when you hear from God, God don't knock you down. God will lift you up. God will always lift you up. Think about that. After Satan tempted Jesus, being full of the Holy Spirit,
The Bible said in Luke 4:14, and Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him throughout all the region round about. As I read that this morning, I began to wonder, what does people say about us? What does people say about us when we been with the Lord? What does people say about us after we've been saved? Does people say, oh, there comes so-and-so. I tell you what, he loves the Lord. Or she loves the Lord. Or do they say, oh, there comes that hypocrite. He says he's one thing out the side of his mouth and another thing out the other side of their mouth. I tell you, you can fool people, but you can't fool God. We got to make sure that we are a good witness. Think about it, church. People knew there was something different about Jesus, because for him, the revealing and the let loosening in the identity of God, the Holy Spirit, was revealed by the Lord Jesus. This was a purpose for the power. Why in the world would God give us the Holy Spirit? The Bible tells us in the Scripture, and I love this message of Scripture, and let me just tell you, it was long ago when I was preaching my trial sermon. I remember I had my whole family in the house, and I had my ironing board, Brother Billy, and I was standing there, and I had the children sitting there, Mary Beth there, and I was standing there beating on the ironing board preaching this verse, and I was in Isaiah 61, but right here in Luke 4:18, it's the same Scripture. I must have preached in my house that night a solid hour. I got to the church that night to do my trial sermon for the church there. They licensed me to preach 5 minutes, and I was through. I mean, it was over. It was just over. Come on now. See, you just got to trust the Lord. You got to trust the Lord. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted and to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind and to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Jesus was preaching his commission from the Holy Spirit. Notice that he has anointed me. He said the Holy Spirit was upon me. He has sent me to preach. He has sent me to heal. He has sent me to deliver. He sent me to recover. He sent me to declare and proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And the Holy Trinity always works in unity with one another. God says, this is my beloved Son. Jesus says, I do what the Father says. And the Holy Spirit says, come to Jesus. We got to come to Jesus. We got to come to him, because he is our only hope. He is the one who took our place, our propitiation. He served and suffered what we should have suffered. You can't have one without the other. Why was the full manifestation of the Holy Spirit held back until this point? Because of the plan of salvation by Almighty God. The Bible said in Hebrews 7:26, for such a high priest became us, the incarnation Jesus, who is holy, he's harmless, undefiled, separated from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. And the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 8:9, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, he's God, yet for your sakes he became a man poor, that we through his poverty and his humility might be rich, become the sons of God. Only because of what Jesus did. Salvation always precedes Pentecost. You've got to have the Savior, and then after you're saved, the evidence that you are saved, you got the Sustainer, the Helper, God, the Holy Spirit. If you're still with me, say amen. The Father kept the Son concealed until he was ready to be revealed unto the world. Think about it, how often Jesus would say, it's not my time yet, and don't tell nobody. And we could see it, was it Jesus' time yet to be doing signs and wonders and miracles? But it was time to be baptized as disciples, but the baptism in which he received in the Jordan. Again, Jesus had not yet been crucified, buried, and raised, and won the victory over the
devil had not yet been manifested. And church, the Holy Ghost power is life-giving power. It's dead-raising power. It's power to go and do what Jesus said was even greater than what he himself would do. Why did he say that? Because Jesus, while he was here, he took on a form just like you and just like me. And you can't be but at one place at one time, and neither can I. But we, people, Christians, all over the world can go all over the world at the same time and do the works of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John 14:12, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me and the works that I do, he shall do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. Jesus is our lawyer. He is our intercessor. And the fact that Jesus left the disciples and went to the Father didn't and doesn't weaken the ability to do the work that Jesus did here in the name of Jesus. But rather, it should strengthen us. That we have somebody is who our mediator. We have somebody to help us. We do not go in our own authority. We go in the name of the Lord Jesus. We don't go in our own power. We go in the power and the anointing of God the Holy Spirit. Notice here, Christ assures them that they should have power to do such works as he had done, that they should have more power than before. Because I go to my Father. Now, did Jesus heal sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead? Well, then why don't we, in the same authority, in the name of Jesus, go out and heal the sick and raise the dead and see a healing? And let me tell you, the greatest healing you're ever going to see is a dead person becoming alive. A person today who is not saved is dead in trespasses and sin. But friend, by the power of the Holy Spirit, come on now, a person can be saved and they can live and never die again and have eternal life. Did Jesus convince and convert sinners and draw multitudes to himself? So shall we. People should. Have you ever had someone come to you and say, listen, I'm under conviction. I just need you to help me get to Jesus. I can remember in my life people coming to the door where I was living saying, preacher, I got to get saved. I mean, we got to be able to tell people in the power of God how to be saved. Though he departed into heaven, the work should not cease nor fall to the ground, but should be carried on as vigilantly and successfully as ever as it was then, so should it be now. And listen, church, that they should go greater works than these. Notice here, the miracle, any size miracle, anything you do is for the glory of God. Jesus healed with the hem of his garment, even a small thing. Peter with his shadow, people were healed. Paul with the handkerchief, people were healed. We're living in the kingdom of grace. And we should be, listen now, doing great works, many signs and wonders and miracles in victories by the word of God, the gospel of Jesus Christ through the working of God the Holy Spirit. Think of that immediate effect at Pentecost, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the speaking in tongues and those of many languages heard the gospel in their own tongue and they were saved. They were saved. It wasn't about that somebody was just speaking in an unknown tongue. It was about that there were so many people there from so many different places, and that God was able to use the voice of somebody and everybody heard it in their own language. That's a mighty miracle. Matthew Henry, very conservative commentator, said this was the greatest sign to them that believed not, and more powerful for the conversion than any other miracle what had ever been done. That day, after Peter preached, the power of the Holy Spirit fell, and they began to speak in the words of Almighty God. Not speaking their own language, but speaking the language of God. John the Baptist was looking for water baptism, but Jesus, let me tell you something. Jesus will baptize you with fire. Jesus will baptize you with fire.
And Jesus never baptized anyone by water. He always baptized them by the power of the fire of Almighty God. An all-consuming fire. It was after he had died on Calvary, risen from the dead, that he appeared to the disciples that evening and conferred on them the new life in the Spirit of God. The Bible said in John 20 that Jesus breathed on them and they received the Holy Ghost. Here is the living Word. The Lord Jesus with these early disciples who had abandoned everything. The thought of the Lord Jesus, all their livelihood. They gave everything to Jesus. They were seeking Him first. And they met Him in the upper room, and Jesus just breathed on them. And the power of the Holy Ghost fell on them. They become new people. They were changed. They went out witnessing and telling people about the Lord Jesus Christ, the Word, and the working of the Holy Spirit. The Scripture is the evidence of the necessity of our need for Jesus being baptized by fire, that we on fire for God. I tell you, you'll be on fire for God or you'll be on fire for something. Well, what is it that's number one in your life today? I tell you what they did, these 120 people, when they got filled and on fire with the Holy Ghost of God about the Lord Jesus, what He had done, what God the Father had done in the life of the Lord Jesus. I tell you one thing, they were going everywhere. They were obedient to God. The Bible said they went and that they waited. Sometimes you got to wait on God. But we don't have enough people going. We don't have enough people going. We got more people going telling a lie than we got people not going who's got the truth. They wanted more Jesus. They wanted more of Him. They received the things of God. God provided for them. Everywhere they went, God provided. Can I get a show of hand today? Has God provided for you? Has God taken care of you? God's not going to abandon you. God will not abandon you. They received from the Lord and they witnessed. And they won people to the Lord Jesus Christ. They won people to the Lord Jesus Christ. I think about this for just a moment. Fire attracts fire. You can look at those fires they have out in California and these big forests of woods and mountains, and fire seems to jump to another place, another fire. But fire attracts fire. Why do we need to come to church? Because, see, we need to be around people who's on fire. We need more fire in our life. We need to be more loose in our life. We need to be on fire for God. On fire for God. I mean, we got to spend our time with the people of God. I don't think if you can't spend time with God's people now, I don't believe you're going to spend time with God's people then. That you love the people of God. That you love people that come to the house of God. You love to see them. You like their enthusiasm. You like to see them worship. You like to see them receive the Word of God in their life. The Bible said when the Word of God went out, the Spirit of God filled them. The Spirit of God filled them from the Word of God. You cannot separate the Spirit of God from the Word of God. I want you to stay on your feet right where you are and no one leaving for just a moment. Billy, you going to sing a song today? Come on now. Listen very carefully. Stand on your feet. Come on now. Stand up for just a moment. You know, there's no greater preaching. And I have preacher friends and I talk to preacher friends. And let me tell you something. There's no greater preaching than when you can talk about something that you have personally experienced. Like my mama's cooking. I can come to your house, but it ain't better than my mama's. Because I had it. And it's good, and she should cook more often. Somebody say amen. But let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. When you've been somewhere and you've seen God work, who can deny it? And you can stand flat-footed, look right square in the devil's face, and tell the devil he's a liar. And I've shared this experience before, but I think it's very appropriate that I share it now. When I was in Romania, I was preaching in house churches because the Christians there didn't have a building to have church. And the house would be full of people and they would be standing outside to hear the gospel preached. And one day I had to go down the street there in a particular city. Not many people have automobiles in Romania. And the city was full of people, Miss Linda. Everywhere you look was people. And so me and an interpreter and a little Baptist girl from Mobile, Alabama, we were sitting on the corner. I said, we got about an hour and a half before we got church. Let's go down to the corner and witness to people. And I'm going to tell you, if you've ever been fishing, Brother Billy, you get in a brim bed, man, you can catch them and catch them and catch them. And we were in a Holy Ghost brim bed. People are getting saved on the street. And when they get saved in Romania, they get on their knees and they weep and they call upon Almighty God. And we stood around like a bunch of peacocks in the face of God Almighty. I'm going to tell you something. Two men came by. I began to speak through the interpreter to these two men about the gospel, the word of God, the scripture I'm preaching about today, the word of God to them, testifying, taking them down the Roman road, and they just got kind of rubbed in the wrong direction, and they began to walk off. And as they walked off, I began to speak to them in another tongue. Came out from them my soul. Another tongue spoke to them. And they came back to the interpreter. And they said, we want to get saved. And they got on their knees and through the interpreter, I led them to Jesus Christ. And they got up weeping and leaping and going down the road. And the interpreter said to me, preacher, I didn't know you could speak German. I said, I'm going to tell you something. I don't know what I said, but I know what I seen. They heard the word of God. And these men were German people. And I heard some time later that during the time of history in the war in Romania, that Germany invaded Romania. And there were a lot of German people living in Romania. And let me tell you something. Everybody needs Jesus. Everybody needs Jesus. And God will take a nobody and put a word in their mouth that can tell somebody how to be saved. You got to make yourself an earthen vessel that God can use you. We stand here today and you brought people. You need to bring people every day. Every time we come to the house of God, anything can happen to anybody in the house of God. Amen. I tell you today, I want you to search yourself. I want you to know this. God loves you. His grace to save you is greater than anything you've ever done. Greater. And if you're not saved today, will you come today doing this song of invitation and give your life to Jesus and leave here a new person, a happy person, saved and heaven bound, sealed until Jesus comes back to get you. God loves you today. You're not here by an accident. If you're not saved today, will you come today? I'm going to step right down here. Brother Billy's going to sing a song of invitation. Maybe you want to come in this altar and say, Lord, like Isaiah, here I am, Lord, send me. Give me souls for my labor. Help me not to be ashamed of the Lord Jesus. God, help me to be a witness. Give me souls, Lord. Help my whole family to be saved. Why in the world does the whole family come to church when you're dead? The whole family ought to be here with you while you're alive. That we can all worship God together. Somebody ought to shout and say amen. You come and come quickly. God's calling. You just come right on. You may feel something. God may be moving on you. I'm going to tell you something. It's not the weather. It's the Holy Spirit of God. He's calling you. You need to come. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Come quickly. Give your life to Jesus. Come quickly. Need to come quickly. We'll meet you here. Need to pray with you. Come if the Lord leads you. Come quickly.
What earthly reason would the heavenly Father send down His Son to suffer rejection?
All well today with your soul. Are you ready to face the Lord today? Have you been saved? Maybe you have been and you're not where you need to be. Find your place. Get it back right with God today. Come quickly.
With the Father, let him hang on a tree. I wept with the answer, the one earthly reason was me.
We got time. If you need to come, come quickly. I don't know I don't know if there's people on other planets. And that really not, none of my business if there's people on other planets. But I do know what the Bible said. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And whosoever will call upon him will not perish, but have everlasting life. If you were the only person, Jesus would die for you. Amen. Come on up here, sister, if you will. Will you give me your name again? Miss Betty Cabestock. She's come today and accepted Jesus as her Lord and Savior. Amen, Miss Betty. We're so proud of you. Thank God for what he's done in your life. The Bible tells us, we studied it in 1 John, that we know that we're saved. And you just told me after we prayed that you're saved, and you know you are. We're glad to have you here. I don't know if you have attended another church or go to another church, but we love to have you here, Open Door. The door is open. We don't vote for people. We just accept you coming. And if you want to be here with us and be a part of this work, you just come on and bring all them other cabbage stalks. Amen. They's a lot in Dillon, ain't they? Amen. Praise the Lord. I think my wife has taught quite a few people that last name. But we're so glad today. We rejoice with you. And let me tell you something. 21 years ago, the Lord said, go to Dillon. And I want you to start a church for everybody. No matter the color of their skin, no matter what they have or don't have, an open door. And God's opened a door here. And this is why we're here, for you coming today and giving your life to Christ. Amen. 21 years have been worth it for you today. And here's how we're going to close our service today. Here's how we're going to close our service today. You come by, if you will, and hug on our new sister in the Lord. We had a birthing here today. She's born again into God's family. She's your sister in the Lord, and we thank God today. You stand right here, and they're going to come by and love on you. We appreciate you being here, and make yourself at home, would you? Amen. Are we going next door? We got food next door. We had talked about and tried to get back to cooking, but it looks like what we're going to do is just continue to pass food out. It's working real good, and we're able to help people get food. So before you leave today, after you come by here and love on our sister, go next door and take some food home with you. Would you say amen? God bless you. Come on by now and love on our new sister in the Lord. Thank God. Amen.